بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and peace be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those that He gathers under His banner, under the banner of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, under His throne, in the hereafter, under His shade, with His no shade except His shade. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And brothers and sisters, stories from the past, stories that are mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem, mentioned by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we want to share with you the way the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shared with the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. And we want to learn and benefit out of those stories, not only delight and entertain ourselves by listening to those stories. And alhamdulillah, for the last few weeks, we've spoken about different stories in the Quran al-Kareem, stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran al-Kareem, and there's no doubt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions those stories in the Quran al-Kareem for us to learn and contemplate those stories and put them into practice from the essence and from the knowledge of those stories. And tonight's story is a story that Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned in Surah Al-Buruj, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in detail in his hadith, in his narration sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is the story of the people of the trench, the people of the ditch. And this story begins and starts off from a young man. That the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us the story of this young man, where he used to be a king, a very oppressive, tyrant, powerful king. And some of the scholars say this king was in Yemen. And we are talking about the time before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as some scholars said, after the time of Isa alayhi salam. This king used to have people around him. He used to have ministers and advisors around him. And from amongst those that used to be close to the king, one of his close advisors was a magician. And one day the magician, when he became old in age, he told and he spoke to the king and he said, I'm getting old in age and I suggest that you send to me a young, bright man that can learn the magic from me. I could impart to him the magic that I've been taught, so if I die, he could continue to advise you and he could continue to be as a support to you. So the king chose a young, bright man, and this young, bright man, from many children or from many men that he saw and he searched for, he chose this young, bright man to be the student of this magician, for the magician to impart that knowledge of magic to this young man. And then this magician started to embrace this young man, teaching him magic and teaching him all the different knowledge and science of magic, even though as Muslims it's haram for us to learn magic and practice magic, because it's one of the major sins of learning magic and practicing magic. And magic does exist, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the existence of magic and the practice of magic in the Quran al-Kareem, many different verses in the Quran al-Kareem. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He speaks about the angels that Allah Azza wa Jal sent down to this earth, and they were teaching people magic. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran al-Kareem, وَمَا كَفَرُوا سُلَيْمَانَ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السَّحْرِ. That Sulaiman did not disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the shayateen disbelieved in Allah azza wa jal while they were teaching people magic. So now you've got this magician, he used to be so close to this king, and he used to be a great and very close advisor to this king, getting old, and he asked the king for the king to choose a young, bright man that can learn the magic from him. If he dies, the king will continue to have this magician nearby him and next to him that will continue to give him an advice. And after the king chose this young, bright man to be the one that would learn from this magician, this young man had sincerity in him. He had purity and sincerity, even though he was not guided at the beginning, but he had purity and sincerity, and he started to learn from the magician. And the magician embraced him, even though he embraced him and taught him the magic, but he was very tough and rough on him, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say that this young man will sit down with the magician and learn from him the magic. And at one stage, the magician will even hit him and beat him if he does not listen to him or follow his instructions. And on the way from home to the magician, he will go past a small house where there is a monk. There is a monk that's worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A rahib, a righteous man, a monk that was worshipping Allah azza wa jal. And this monk was in accordance, or he was following the religion of Isa alayhi salam, who was following Islam, the Sharia of Isa alayhi salam. And he was hiding away from the rest of the army or the soldiers and the king's followers, from the fear if the king finds out about him, the king will torture him. Because one of the narrations says that this king was forcing people to worship him. And he used to claim lordship. He used to say that he's the Lord of the universe and he is God, and people must surrender to him and people must submit to him and adhere to him, and me people must obey him because he believes he's the king. And that's why this monk used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hiding away from everyone else, not disclosing his worship to Allah from the fear that the king's soldiers and followers will take him to the king, in return the king will torture him and kill him. But subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted this young man who is learning from this magician the magic to go past him every single day, and for this young man to meet this monk. And one day he sat down with this monk and he asked the monk to teach him, to teach him some of the knowledge that he knows, to teach him some of this religious science and knowledge that he has. And this young man will listen to this monk day after day, until the magician start to realize that this young man is arriving to him late. And then when he goes home, he's arriving home late. So he complained to the monk and he said to him that now the magician is getting so angry from me. And he started to hit me because I'm late to him. So what should I say to him? What should I do? So the monk told him that when you arrive late to the magician, say to him that my parents held me back. And when you arrive late to your parents, say to him the magician held me back. And every day on his way to the magician to learn the magic from the magician, he'll go past this monk and learn something of Islam. He'll learn something of the religion of this monk. Until one day he was in that state of confusion. Should he go with what the magician tells him, or should he go with what the monk tells him? So one day this young man, while he was going to the magician, he went past a group of people that were standing and they were afraid of a big beast. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions this hadith, there was a big beast that people were very afraid from and people were running away from. So this young man grabbed a rock, he grabbed a stone, and he said, today is the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will clear things to me. Today is the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show me the true path. And then he grabbed this stone and rock, and then he said, oh Allah, if the religion of the monk is dearer to you and more beloved to you than what the magician is teaching me, then kill this beast with this rock. And he casted this rock, he threw it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala killed the beast. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of this young man, and the beast was killed with this stone that before this young man threw and casted the stone. He said, oh Allah, if the religion of the monk is more dearer to you and more beloved to you than what the magician is teaching me, then kill this beast with this rock. And the beast was killed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed it. So this young man realized that the religion that he's been taught by this monk is more dearer to Allah Azza wa Jal, and it is without a doubt the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than what the magician is teaching him, than what the magician is imparting to him. And then he went back to his teacher, he went back to the monk, and he told him the story and exactly what happened and what he intended out of throwing and casting this rock. So the monk told him, oh son, today you are becoming more dearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than me. You are becoming more superior than me. And because you are excelling in this knowledge of this religion, and because you are becoming more better and superior to me, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no doubt that Allah azza wa jal will test you and trial you. And if one day you are tested, if one day you are trialed, and if one day you are captured by the king or his soldiers, do not inform them of me. Don't tell them anything about me. And subhanallah, this young man started to learn more about Islam, more of the religion of the monk, And as I mentioned before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only sent one religion, and that's a religion of Islam. And all the prophets and the messengers came with one religion, and that's a religion of Islam. However, they had different legislations, different sharia, different rulings in different aspects when it comes to your everyday life and everyday thing. And this young man started to excel in Islam, started to excel in that knowledge that this monk had imparted to him. And then he started not only that, but he reached to the level, he reached to the stage where he now started to heal and give recovery to those who are ill. He started to restore the sight of those who are blind, and he started to give recovery to those who have leprosy and those who have other illness through the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Through the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. So now this young man, with his righteousness, with his piety and knowledge, he reached to that level where now he could heal people through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course. It's all coming from Allah Azza wa Jal. And then now the word started to spread amongst that city where there is a young righteous man. He can give recovery and healing to those who are ill. He could restore the sight back to those who are blind. He could give the hearing back to those who are deaf. He could restore the colors of skin, or the skin becomes normal to those who are leper. And he is to give recovery and healing to those who are ill. Until one day, one of the close advisors and ministers to the king, who was a blind man, heard of this young man. So he went and visited him and asked him to restore his sight. He asked him to give him recovery. So this young man said to him, I could only do that by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am not the one that heals anyone. I'm not the one that gives cure or recovery to anyone. It's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you want Allah azza wa jal to give you recovery, and if you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to restore your sight, then believe in Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you what you want. So this minister, this close friend and consultant and advisor to the king, he testified that there's no God except Allah, the Lord of this young man, and he believed in Islam, believed in the Lord of this young man. So this young man, on the spot, asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and right away, asked Allah azza wa jalla to restore his sight, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restored his sight. This is the righteousness and the piety that this young man had reached to. And what's so hard about that? These are the miracles that Allah Azza wa Jal will emerge and make appear on the hands of those who are righteous and those who are pious. It happened on the hands of the prophets and the messengers. It happened on the hands of our beloved prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not only one or two or three miracles, but tens and tens of miracles that emerged and appeared on the hands of our beloved prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And later on the hands of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. This is righteousness. This is piety. When you are so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's nothing impossible on Allah azza wa jal. Allah can do whatever He wants, however He wants. And this young righteous man became so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he became so righteous and pious that Allah azza wa jal wanted to use him as a tool and a means of people to be attracted to Islam. And this close advisor to the king, he was blind, he went and believed in Allah, followed the religion of this young man. And in return, this young man asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to restore his sight to him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him his sight. And then one day, this previous blind minister, who now sits next to the king, sighting, after the king had encountered him and experienced him not sighting and blind, he sees his advisor and minister sighting. He could see as normal. So the king asks him, he tells him, where did you get this from? Who gave you and restored your sight back to you? Who gave you cure? Who gave you recovery? Who restored your sight to you? So he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The minister, the close advisor to the king, he said, Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that restored my sight back to me. So the king told him, is there another Lord beside me? Are there other Lords beside me? I'm the only Lord in this universe. I am the only Lord in this world. So he said, no, Rabbi wa Rabbuka Allah, my Lord and your Lord is Allah Azza wa Jal. My Lord and your Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one that created you. He's the one that created me. And He's the one that created everyone. And He is the one that gave me my sight back to me. He's the one that restored my sight back to me. So the king started to torture him. He started to punish him, persecute him, torture him and torture him and torture him, until this advisor spoke out. Until this advisor disclosed everything. And what did he disclose? He mentioned this young man. He said, the one that brought my sight to me and the one that called me to this religion is a young righteous man. So who brought him? The king. And the king saw him. This is the young man that I chose to be taught by my magician. So later on, he could take the responsibility and the task and the post of this magician. And then he looks at him and says, oh, young man, it looks like that your knowledge of magic had surpassed and went beyond your own teacher. So he thinks that it's all magic. He thinks that this young man has been taught this magic by his magician and is saying to him, wow, you surpassed and you went beyond your own teacher. Now you are even better than your own teacher. Your teacher taught you magic and now you're even better than him. So this young man, he says, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gives recovery to whoever he wants. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that restores the sight to whoever he wants. And Allah azza wa jal is the one that makes changes however he wants. Allah is my Lord, He's your Lord, He's the creator of the universe, He's your creator, He's my creator. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the master of everyone. So the king became so angry. What's this thing that he's experiencing? He chose this young man to be taught by the magician, and now this young man goes against him and against the magician. And not only that, he is calling for something new. He's calling people to a new Lord, to a new religion that the king is becoming so outraged and angry of. So I start to torture this young man and torture this young man and torture this young man until the young man spoke of the monk. He had to spit it out and he spoke of the monk. So the king went and captured through his soldiers, captured the monk and brought him forward. And then the king asked the monk, who do you worship? He said, I worship Allah. Who do you believe in? He said, I believe in Allah. So the king said, I tell you right now to denounce the religion that you are worshiping or the religion that you are following and the Lord that you are worshiping, or otherwise I'll kill you. So he insisted upon this monk to change his religion and to denounce the religion that he's following and the Lord that he's worshiping. But the monk continued to withstand his position and continued to be steadfast until the king killed him. He brought a sword and he put it over his head and he chopped him into two pieces. Then he brought his advisor and minister and he told him, who do you worship? He said, I worship Allah Azza wa Jal. He told him, I'll give you last chance for you to denounce the religion that you follow and the Lord that you worship, or otherwise I'll kill you the way I killed the monk. So this advisor said, there is no God except Allah and no one is worthy to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the king also chopped him into two halves by putting the sword over his head and he killed him. Now he came to this young man. The king brought him forward and he said to him, who do you worship? He said, I worship Allah and I follow the religion of Allah. So the king told him, I'll give you last chance for you to denounce this religion that you follow and this Lord that you worship before I kill you, the way I killed your teacher, the monk, and the advisor that I had close to me. So this young man insisted to say, there is no God except Allah. There is no religion except the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I would not change my religion for anyone. So the king commanded his soldiers to take him to a particular mountain, to walk up and climb the mountain together until they reach the peak of the mountain, and for them to throw him out of the mountain if he does not denounce the religion that he's following. So he commanded them to take him to the mountain, let him climb the mountain. When he reaches the peak, tell him, do you denounce the religion that you follow? Do you denounce the Lord that you worship? Or otherwise we'll throw you out of this mountain. So they took him to the mountain and climbed with him to the mountain. While this young man is climbing the mountain, he said, oh Allah, I ask you to protect me from them. Oh Allah, I ask you to safeguard me from them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shook the mountain and all the soldiers fell dead except this young boy, except this young man. And what did he do? He did not run away. He did not escape. He did not flee. On the contrary, he went back to the king. He went to the palace of the king and stood in front of the king to show him that he is on the true path. And this is the character of the believer. The believer doesn't think twice when it comes to the haqq. The believer continues to be steadfast and continues to be firm when it comes to pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This young man could have had the chance to flee and escape, but he wanted to prove a point that the only one that's worthy to be worshipped is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only Lord of the universe is Allah Azza wa Jal. The only Lord that people must surrender and adhere to is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he came back to the king and he stood before the king, and the king was shocked. So he asked him, where are my soldiers? Where are my people? What happened to those soldiers that went with you? So he said, Allah protected me from them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected me from them. Allah safeguarded me from them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala got rid of them. So the king became so angry. And then he commanded his soldiers to take him in the middle of the ocean, to go in a boat and to go in the middle of the ocean. And he told his soldiers that once you arrive in the deep part of the ocean, at the deep end of the ocean, ask him to denounce his religion. And if he refuses, then throw him and let him drown in the ocean. So they took him on a boat and they went in the deep end of the ocean. And then they told him, do you denounce the Lord that you worship and the religion that you follow? He said, there is no one worthy to be worshipped except Allah Azza wa Jal and the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they wanted to throw him and drown him. So he said, oh Allah, protect me from them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala flipped the boat upside down and made them all drown except him. Allah saved him and he came back to the king. He didn't escape. He didn't flee. He had the opportunity to escape. He had the opportunity to flee. But he wanted to prove a point that the only one that's worthy to be worshipped is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The true religion is the religion of Allah. The true path is the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. So he comes back to the king and stands before the king. And the king looks at him so astonished, so amazed, what's happening here? And he says to him, what happened to my soldiers? What happened to my people? So he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected me from them. Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed them. So the king became so angry, so outraged. And then he started to think about other ways to destroy and kill this young man. So this young man tells him, there is no way you could kill me. There is no way that you could kill me. Think of whatever you want to think of. Try and kill me in any way that you want to kill me. By Allah, you will never kill me, because I have Allah on my side. And this is the quality of the mu'min. Believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is on his side or her side. And once you have Allah on your side, you should not be concerned over anything. You should not be worried over anything. Once you have Allah on your side, you've got everything. And when you don't have Allah on your side, you've got no one. When you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with you, you've got everything, even though you've got nothing. And when you don't have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with you, you've got nothing, even though that you think you've got everything. The power is from Allah and the strength is from Allah. So this young man, he tells this king, there is no way for you to get rid of me. There's no way for you to kill me, but I could give you the way that you could get rid of me. I could give you the way that you could get rid of me. If you want to kill me, you want to get rid of me, I'll tell you the way. So the king told him how. He said, you gather the people of this city, get them together, and then you tie me on a trunk of a tree, and then you take from my, you take my arrow and bow, and then you take one of my arrows and shoot it at me. But before you shoot it at me, you say, in the name of the Lord of this young man. In the name of the Lord of this young man. So the king did exactly what this young man told him. Little does he know, it's a trap that this young man wants everyone to hear of Islam, wants everyone to hear of the Lord that he is worshipping. So he gathered the people of that city, and some narrations say hundreds of thousands of people gathered around this young boy being tied up on that trunk of a tree. And then he got one of his soldiers, and then that soldier took the arrow and bow, and then he pointed it at this young man, and loudly he said, in the name of Allah, the Lord of this young man. In the name of Allah, the Lord of this young man. And then he shot this young man with his own bow and arrow. He shot him with his own arrow and then hit his temple on the side of his head. And then this young man grabbed where the arrow had hit his head, and he died. Who's watching everything? The entire city is watching everything. Everyone that's there is watching exactly what's happening. Everyone just saw with their own eyes exactly what's happening, and everyone had heard of what's been happening, that the king tried to kill this young man so many times and did not succeed. But now when this young boy tells him exactly how to kill him and to shoot him with his own arrow and to say in the name of Allah, the Lord of this young man, now everyone heard that. So what happened? Over 70,000. Over 70,000 of them said, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, the Lord of this young man. There is no God except Allah, the Lord of this young man." So people came up to the king and he said, "What you were concerned over and what you were fearful over happened. This young boy entrapped you in a very deep trap. He told you to kill him, but look what happened in return. More than half of your city embraced Islam. More than half of your city followed the religion of this young boy. More than half of the city now are believing in the Lord of this young boy." So the king became so angry and he became so outraged. So he wanted to torture anyone who denounced their religion by believing in him and believing in the religion of this young man. So what he did, he commanded his soldiers to dig up trenches, ditches, and he commanded for fires to be lit on inside those ditches. And then he commanded anyone that denounced his previous religion and followed the religion of this young boy to be thrown in the fire if they do not denounce the religion of this young man. So he started to grab people and thousands of them. And before they cast them into the trench, before they cast them into the fire, before they cast them into this blazing fire in the ditch and trench, they will ask them, "Who do you worship?" If they say, "We worship Allah, the Lord of this young man," they'll be thrown in that trench. And then they'll bring one after the other, and whoever says, "No, I worship the king," they'll let go of him. They'll free him. Until a mother, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, until a mother carrying her baby, a newborn baby, she is carrying her own baby with her own hands and arms, she was brought forward to be thrown into that trench, into that ditch where there's fire in it. And then she hesitated. When they asked her, "Who do you worship?" she thought twice about it. If I'm gonna say I worship Allah, the Lord of this young man, that will kill me and kill my baby. So when she hesitated, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made her baby speak. And he said to her, "Oh mom, have patience. You are on the truth." So they threw her and her baby in that ditch. They threw her and her baby in that trench. This trench with this fire in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted a miracle to take place. A miracle for people to see and a miracle for people to hear. That when you are with Allah, Allah is with you. And when you stand with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jalla will support you. This is a mother that became hesitant, not because she does not believe in Allah, because she was concerned and fearful over her baby. But Allah made this baby encourage her. This same baby that she was concerned over and she was afraid over, Allah Azza wa Jalla made this baby encourage her and made this baby to be the source of motivation for her. So she said, "I worship Allah." So they threw her and her baby in that ditch. Allahu Akbar. What an amazing thing. But because of this young boy who was willing to sacrifice his life for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his da'wah spread even after his death. And this is the quality of the da'i. The quality of the da'i will exhaust himself or herself, but for the sake of lighting and illuminating the light of Islam to others. Like a candle, it burns and melts itself, but it lights up what surrounds it and what's around it. This is the quality of the mu'min. The quality of the mu'min sacrifices for the sake of Allah to build and to strengthen Islam in his life and the life of others. To spread the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah azza wa jal mentions this event in the Quran Kareem, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ, by the sky containing great stars, وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ, and the promised day, وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودٍ, and the witness and those who are there witnessing on, قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُودِ. Allah azza wa jal says, cursed be upon those who built and dug up that ditch. The people of the ditch, cursed be upon those, the people of the ditch,
the people who dug up the ditch and threw those believers in the ditch. And النَّارِ ذَاتِ الْوَقُودِ, the fire full of fuel. It was full of blazing fire in it. إِذْ هُمْ عَلَيْهَا قُعُودِ, they were sitting nearby just watching the innocent believers burning and melting inside that ditch. وَهُمْ عَلَى مَا يَفْعَلُونَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ شُهُودِ, and they had witnessed everything that the believers had done. وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. The only problem they had with these believers is they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the praiseworthy Allah, Al-Aziz Al-Hamid. That's the only crime. That's the only thing that they saw and they believed that these believers did, is that they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they believed in Allah, they tortured them. Because they believed in Allah, they punished them. Because they believed in Allah, they burnt them. Because they believed in Allah, they killed them. وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. They only resented them because they believe in Allah, the Aziz, the most high, the exalted, the almighty, al-hamid, the praiseworthy, alladhi lahu mulku as-samawati wal-ard, wallahu ala kulli shay'in shahid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dominion of the heavens and the earth, the one that witnesses everything. Allah was witnessing what's happening, but these people are thrown in the fire, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make that fire to be their path to the paradise. Allah will make this fire to be their road and their path to the paradise. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمُ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ. Those who had tortured the believers, those who had tortured the believers, the male believers and the female believers, then they did not repent to Allah and feel guilty and remorse over their actions, Allah will punish them a severe punishment in the hereafter. If you think you are punishing them in the fire of this world, then see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish you in His punishment, in His fire in the hereafter. Wait and see. Wait and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do for you. Wait and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish you in return. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to say, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْكَبِيرِ. Those who believe in Allah and those who do righteous actions and deeds, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them the paradise in which rivers flow from beneath it. The rivers flow from beneath the paradise. ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْكَبِيرِ. Indeed, this is the greatest attainment. This is the greatest success. So if these people think that by them torturing the believers in a ditch and they are going into the hellfire, and they are the ones who are being saved, and they are the ones who are enjoying life, well, let them think twice, because those who are thrown in the ditch shall enter the paradise of Allah, and those that threw them in the ditch, they'll enter the punishment of Allah in the hellfire that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created for people like this, for people who torture the believers. My brothers and my sisters, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Inna batsha rabbika lashadid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so powerful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so strong. When Allah Azza wa Jalla determines something or Allah decrees something, it will happen the way Allah wants it to happen. But Allah puts us through tests. And through the tests that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us in return. Our success is through the tests that we endure. Our achievement and our accomplishments is through the trials that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts us through. The true believer looks forward to that moment that Allah puts him through the test. The true mu'min looks forward to that moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries him or trials her. Because he and she knows that this is the moment that you get promoted with Allah. This is the moment that you get closer to Allah. This is the moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to succeed, wants you to prosper. This is a young man. He was willing to sacrifice his own life for the sake of Islam and spreading the da'wah of Islam. And he did sacrifice his life. He did sacrifice his life for the sake of prevailing the truth and showing others the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him a legacy to the Day of Judgment. Allah Azza wa Jal made him a legacy to the Day of Judgment, verses to be recited to the Day of Judgment, a hadith to be read to the Day of Judgment about this young man. And my advice now is to our young brothers, to our young sisters, you are something in Islam. You could be something in Islam. You could be someone in Islam. You could serve Islam even though that you are young. Look this young man. Like this young man who served Islam by his perseverance and steadfastness, by him withstanding his position, by him not backing down, by him not being afraid from anyone. And this is the quality of the mu'min. Does not fear anyone except Allah. Does not fear anyone beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always strong, always firm, always steadfast. No matter what we experience, no matter what we witness, no matter what we face, no matter what we endure, at the end we are strong because we are with Allah. We are strong because we believe in Allah. We are strong because we follow the path of Allah. Nothing deters us away from Allah Azza wa Jal. Nothing deviates us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing takes us away from Allah Azza wa Jal. That's me as a mu'min. That's me as a believer. Like this young man. Nothing deterred him away from Allah. And nothing took him away from Allah. And he continued to be strong even though he had the opportunity and the chance to escape. But he came back to prove that there is no God except Allah. He did not run away from the battle. He did not run away from confronting anyone, even though it's the king. Even though he's an aggressive king. And this is the quality of the mu'min. He does not run away from anyone. Does not escape from anyone, especially when he is upholding the truth and he believes in the truth and he utters the truth and he speaks the truth, because he knows the truth. Allah Azza wa Jal will always be behind him as long as he and she stands by the truth. This is the quality of the mu'min and this is the quality of the believer. These days, nowadays, the moment we experience something little, we straight away collapse. We want to change our names, change our identity. We want to take off the hijab. We don't even want people to know we are Muslims. Why? Because we are afraid that someone will be confronting or intimidating towards us. Be strong, be firm. And know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching. As Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Wallahu ala kulli shay'in shaheed. Indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching and witnessing everything. Allah is watching you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting you through this event and this ordeal to see your reaction, what you do. How do you react? What do you say? What do you do? This is very important for me to keep at the back of my mind. When I'm experiencing things like that, encountering things like that, know for a fact that Allah is watching you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could be testing you to see your reaction. Do you continue to withstand your position? Or do you back down? Do you walk away? Do you get scared? The mu'min doesn't get scared from anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mu'min does not fear anyone except Allah Azza wa Jal. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqu allaha haqqa tuqatih. Or those who believe, fear Allah the way he should be feared. Fear Allah Azza wa Jal the way he should be feared. And do not die unless you're on the state of Islam. Part of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the right of Allah upon us that we fear him more than anyone else. Like this young man who did not fear anyone except Allah, even though he was threatened, even though he was persecuted, he was tortured, even though the king told him, I will kill you, and he sent the soldiers with him to kill him, but he continued to withstand his position. Did not fear anyone except Allah. And what happened in return? Allah protected him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him overpower his own enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him dominate his own enemies. That he was a one man on his own, one young man on his own, against an entire army, an entire kingdom, an entire powerful kingdom, but he was strong to face and encounter all this. This is why, because he knew he is with Allah. He knew he is with Allah, so he was not afraid of anyone. And why should he be afraid of anyone when he is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why should he be afraid of anyone if he is doing this for the sake of Allah? Like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he told Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, while them two were in the cave, and the non-believers and the chiefs and the leaders and the horsemen and the soldiers of the people of Quraysh arrived to the mountain of Thawr, and Abu Bakr became so concerned over the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he tells the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, O Messenger of Allah, once they come near this cave, they will see us. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he says, Ya Abu Bakr, ما ظنك باثنين الله ثالثهما لا تحزن إن الله مع إن الله معنا. O Abu Bakr, what do you think of two? Me and you. Allah is the third one amongst us. O Abu Bakr, don't be afraid of everyone. Don't be frightened of anyone. But fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that Allah Azza wa Jalla is with us. Don't be afraid of anyone, don't be petrified of anyone, and know that Allah is with us. And since Allah is with us, we should not be concerned over anyone. We should not be frightened of anyone. Fear Allah, and Allah make everyone fear, and Allah will make everyone fear you. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will support you against anyone. Fear Allah azza wa jal, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be by your side. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will support you. This is the quality of the mu'min. قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُودِ النَّارِ ذَاتِ الْوَقُودِ إِذْ هُمْ عَلَيْهَا قُعُودِ وَهُمْ عَلَى مَا يَفْعَلُونَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ شُهُودِ وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. Surah Al-Buruj, a hadith that's been narrated by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Sahih Muslim, the story of this young man and the people of the ditch, the people of the trench. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen and hear, act upon what they listen and hear. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.